government is urging those over the age of 60 to register for the COVID-19 vaccine, but so many don't have access to that registration process. This could be a struggle for millions of those South Africans without internet access. My next guest is someone who's dedicated her life to ensuring that there is quality access to quality health care for all South Africans. Associate Professor Lydia Cairncross is a health and human rights activist, along with her very impressive day job. Lydia, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Now, you're the head of the Breast and Endocrine Surgery Unit at UCT and at Groote Schuur Hospital. I imagine for us just to start this conversation, it must have been very difficult this last year to juggle looking after those patients for the Breast and Endocrine Unit, as well as forming part of the hospital's response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Give us a sense of the challenges or of just the process of this balancing act that you and your team have had to face over the last year or so.
Good morning, Marcel, and to the listener and to the viewers, and thank you for the kind introduction. Yes, it's been a stressful time for all health workers, and I think from the surgical perspective, what has been particularly difficult is that we've had to de-escalate so many of our services around the time of COVID-19. So we've had to close theatre lists and clinics, and we know that the massive surgical backlogs and waiting times that preceded COVID were already something that we were battling with. And so that continues to be an issue that we will take through into the post-COVID phase. But as COVID rises, our surgical services would drop down and we would realign what we were doing within the hospital in order to balance all the services that were running.
And now you're also a member of the People's Health Movement of South Africa, an NGO, and through your work with them, you initiated community-level COVID training workshops in various areas, and some would call them at-risk areas in the Cape Town area. Tell us what those workshops covered and what kind of impact it had on those communities.
So we started community COVID training workshops around the time that the first lockdown was easing, because we knew that people needed to start moving around, people needed to do the things to ensure their livelihoods and to sustain communities. So we targeted the workshops really at community leadership, and by that we mean people that are involved in things such as health committees, running soup kitchens, assisting with preschools, neighborhood watches, as well as formal community leadership. And these were small group workshops in the communities, face-to-face. We ran them with 10 to 15 people at a time, and the actual process of the workshop became a training site. So how do we sit together safely? So we meet in small groups, we meet outside, we used sanitizer, we showed people how to safely have tea breaks and lunches and so on. And then the content on the workshop in the workshop was understanding the COVID-19 virus, how it spreads and how to prevent that. But a second and more important part of that was, how do we identify then the barriers in this particular community, be that Guguletu, Khayelitsha, Blikkiesdorp, Manenberg? How do we identify right here what it is that makes it difficult to physically distance, to find a quality mask, to buy sanitizer when we know that people are struggling to feed their families, particularly during this time? So the workshops balance the medical knowledge as well as the contextual specific knowledge, where community voices are actually the experts. Mm-hmm. They know better than doctors exactly what it means to identify the high-risk areas in a community, whether it be a shebeen or a taxi rank, or whether it be shopping malls where people are actually sharing masks, for example.
And I think it was last year I was in conversation with an academic researcher at Stellenbosch University, and they spoke about how there was a big need for there to be a focus on community-level work when at that time it was about getting this message out there, and that South Africans react more to that kind of communication than we do to heavy-handed do this or else, or our obsession with the messages on social media and that kind of thing. Do you believe there's been enough of a focus on the importance of this community-level work?
Absolutely. I mean, I was hoping, and many of us were hoping, that we would see this around every clinic and every health facility in the country. So it was amazing to see that despite the amount of information that had been around COVID, people actually didn't really internalize that, because they hadn't sat opposite somebody and had a dialogue about what that really meant for them. And we found that again now with vaccine training, because we've shifted our emphasis now to vaccine literacy. It's very different when you hear something on the radio radio or see something on your phone. And when you can sit with somebody and through a conversation, unpack what your fears and concerns and issues might be around a particular thing. So that kind of community engagement is critical. And South Africa is really gifted because of the legacy of our struggle against apartheid and the legacy and the current struggle for survival that many South Africans face, that we have a really rich, engaged civil society. People are vocal and organized. That energy is there. We need to connect that energy to the health policies that are being discussed at a national and provincial level. And those policy discussions need to connect with the conversations that are happening in communities, because we need to understand what it is that makes or does not make somebody implement, for example, physical distancing. People are not deliberately trying to put themselves at risk, but there may be things that we don't understand as health specialists or as policymakers that make it very, very difficult for people to implement things. So that community engagement and connection is at the center, I think, of any real public health intervention.
Now, the coronavirus pandemic, it's pretty obvious that the pandemic has brought into sharp focus the vast inequalities in South Africa, one of, if not the most unequal society in the world. But both locally and, of course, internationally, it's brought that into focus. How are you hoping the approach to quality health care will change post the coronavirus pandemic?
Thanks, Marcel. So for that, I need an hour, but I'll just make one point on this, because there are many lessons to learn from COVID-19. I'll make 2 points. First, we need one health system. The two-tier health system once again has been shown to be highly problematic, results in inequality, and actually decreases quality of care. So we need one health system for everybody. But the second thing that we need is we need to build that bridge between the health system and the community it serves. At the moment, when I worked in the hospital at Krodeski and I was seeing what I was seeing, people in the community that I was serving did not understand what was happening in the hospital corridors, and I did not understand what was happening in those communities. And that bridge requires a particular kind of health worker. That requires community health workers, and it requires health promoters. Mm-hmm. So I would love to see that we learn the lesson that we need to appoint into our communities trained, remunerated, recognized community health workers and health promoters who are in communities where they live and work and can be that conduit between the health system and communities all the time, not only around COVID-19, but also around the other epidemics that we face, such as TB, HIV, trauma and violence, maternal mortality, and so on. If we can establish a strong community bridge through community health workers and health promoters, we will be in a better place to face any pandemic that might come in the future, because we will have those health workers to translate the rapidly changing message up and down between the health system and communities.
Okay, we're going to leave it there, but you're right. We could speak about that topic for hours, a very important topic indeed. Thank you so much. That's Associate Professor Dr. Lydia Caron-Cross. She's a health and human rights activist. Her day job is she's head of the breast and endocrine surgery unit at UCT at Groote Hospital, and she's also doing very important and much-needed work with the People's Health Movement of South Africa. We thank her for her time this morning.